Gavin Rubinstein.
My man.
One of Australia's best and most successful real estate agents, in my humble opinion.
Appreciate that.
And an incredible brand, the Rubinstein Group, and of course, one of the stars in the Luxe Listings. Welcome to Chew the Fat. Now, today you've asked for a vodka pasta.
I have.
The goal here is to hopefully have it the best you've ever tried, so when you get stuck have a bite.
If it's not the best I've ever tried.
You tell me the truth. You tell me the truth. We're not here now. Before we start, I want you to mix the cheese. Yeah. Get a little bit in there, yeah. No, unfortunately,
I get too much cold there.
That's okay.
That's pretty good, man.
Pretty good? Well, the trouble is to always keep it al dente still when we've been sitting here for 10 minutes, so. Nice.
All right. Not the best.
Oh, damn it.
But it's up there.
Okay, that's good. I love the honesty. I love the honesty. So, where I want to start today is why a vodka pasta?
It's hard to go wrong with something simple. Mm-hmm. And I think at the core of it, like, I'm pretty simple dude at the end of the day. I really am. I think it may not look that way, but that's always been my formula. And I keep it to the classics. Like, usually when I'm, you know, feeling like I'm not hungry, but I have to eat, I order a pasta and I'm never not going to be able to eat a dish like that. Yeah, you know what I mean? So, and I just enjoy to eat it, so.
Nice, love that. So looking at what you've achieved and where you are today, what would the 19-year-old version of you that started your career be shocked by?
Nothing.
Nothing?
No.
What would you be most proud by?
Everything. Right now, definitely at the top is watching my colleague and my contemporary, Oliver Lavers, last week get awarded number one salesperson for New South Wales across the Ray White Group.
Amazing.
That was just a dream of mine for the last kind of 4 years. When I left the previous office I was working at and I started TRG, which at the time was Ray White TRG, one of the parts of the deal with the White family was, you know, we wanted to remain being in competition with the whole Ray White Group because, you know, naturally it's the largest Australian real estate brand, and much better to pin yourself against the best in the business rather than just a smaller pool. I find always good to use someone or something or be chasing, you know, something that you have to beat because it gets the best out of you. And naturally when I opened my own business, I went from competing in the salesperson category to competing in the principal, which is the business owner category. And I made a point at that time, putting out a video next week around it, that you know, I was really focused on contributing to try and build the number one salesperson. And there are a lot of good names in that category, right? Like you've got Augusto Gerecani, you've got Warren Ginsberg, you've got some really good players who only beat as number one. I think a few people are kind of like, because he's a silent achiever too, right? I think a few people just looked last week and went, what, number one? So him and I had that in the works for a long time, and that definitely is right now at the top of my list.
That's awesome. And I noticed as you said that your face lit up and there's that twinkle in your eye, and I respect that a lot. I want to know why. Like, why is it so important to you to see that success, knowing your competitive nature, but seeing that success in someone else?
I'm a loyal guy, you know? At the end of the day, Ollie started with me 8-9 years ago.
Nice.
So he's like a nine year overnight success. You used that phrase when we were talking before. I like that. And I value loyalty above everything else. I value trust, respect. I'm not saying every day since I've met Ollie, we have never had an argument, but we've had very few. Mm. We've got great synergy. We've got a great understanding of working. We've got a great partnership. Yeah, I love giving back to people who give to me, right? Like when I was competing in that category, I got it 7 years in a row. And you've got to find new ways to keep your motivation alive and keep going in this business. I think in all businesses anyway, right? Because it can be quite tedious at times, real estate sales or just sales in general. And so when you've been doing, you know, something for so long, I'm 15 years odd in the game, at such a high level, repetitiveness can become mundane. Not saying for 1 second I find anything about what I do mundane. There are some parts. But opening my business and starting my business, I changed a lot. You know, I went from having to live this very selfish life, because as a real estate salesperson, it's all about you. It's about your sales. It's about, you know, your mindset. It's all you, you, you. And that shifted when I opened up my business, because I started to have to really think about other people and be a hell of a lot more considerate about, you know, the people who are working with me. And I also wanted to answer a lot of the questions I know people had at the time, which was, all Gavin is a salesperson. You know, is Gavin a leader? Can he build people? Will this work, right? Because usually salespeople are just salespeople. They're one track, they're not multifaceted. I've always known who I am, so it's great to tick it off the list.
Oh, I love that. That's awesome. And I can see how real it is, and that's epic.
Thank you.
So staying on that track around the leadership, like, what do you think it is that, you know, I hate when people say, what is the one thing? Because there's no one thing. But what are those key things that you believe as a leader that you bring to your team that differentiates you from the rest?
I think it's energy, man. I think it's like our commodities. I can only talk about real estate salespeople. Our commodities are energy. Our commodities are time management. And like, I lead from the front. So like Ollie is an example, just while we're on him. I've got a lot of great guys, but while we're talking about him, you know, I've never asked him to do something that I didn't do or I don't do every single day.
Yeah.
I'm just doing, like I say, a hell of a lot more on top of that. Mm. But I haven't stopped listing and selling, right? I don't know if you saw at the awards, I got number one principal.
I did.
National and international myself. So I think that's a big piece, right? And the closer these guys work to the sun, and I'd be the sun in this scenario, I think the more they see how easy it is, the more they see how possible it is. Mm. Because like I said at the start of this interview, I'm a pretty simple dude. It's pretty basic if you get it, if you've got the work ethic, if you understand what's required to be done, and you've got that never give up persistent attitude. And you know, ensuring I bring the energy every day, lead from the front, and work with people who are aligned, that's kind of created what TRG is.
That's awesome. I love that. And one of the things that, like, when I walk in this office today, when I see your brand and when I've seen your content, is this perception I get from every one of those facets is you're a man who's driving towards perfection.
Yeah.
Would that be an accurate statement?
Yeah, it's a battle, man. It's a damn battle, because perfection doesn't exist.
Yes.
And it's frustrating to not achieve it, particularly when you're in pursuit of something that doesn't exist. But it never stops my pursuit of it, because I know if I keep that energy, I'm only gonna get close.
Yes.
And close to perfection is ultimately good enough, because it's better than most, yes, right? Because most people don't even pursue it in the first place. So,
for sure.
But every aspect of what I do, I'm a perfectionist. Call that OCD, or you can just call it that I know exactly what I want and how I want it.
I love that. So I'm going to take the perfectionism and that the strive for perfection, and I'm going to juxtapose it against one of our, you know, one of the quotes that personally I brought a lot into the business that we ran was, don't let perfection get in the way of progress.
Yeah.
And so when I say that, what do you think?
I don't. I mean, I think when I look for people to join this office, I look for two aspects, right? Number one is work ethic.
Yeah.
No matter what people say, think of myself or TRG, even if they know it or have an opinion, there's absolutely no one who can say Gavin, has not got an unbelievably dedicated, consistent work ethic. Mm-hmm. Number two is everyone here is motivated by progression. Mm-hmm. So that's something that's always motivated me. That's something that's always driven me, you know, being better today than yesterday. It doesn't have to be by, you know, but just by a little bit, and constantly having the passion to want to learn. And that's what I love most about the business. So I think, I'd never let perfection, I'm not one of these guys, that's not perfect, I won't do it, you know? When I fuck up, when I make mistakes, and my God, do I make mistakes? Like, I probably make more mistakes than anybody. It's just about learning from it.
Yeah.
And so to me, that's my definition of progress. Everyone has different definitions of lots of things. My definition of progress is learning. It's you know, evolving. It's becoming better. And I think that's such a big part of who I am as not only a practitioner, a real estate practitioner, but a person. that I would 100% agree with that quote, and it doesn't affect it.
Yeah, nice, love that. And give me an example, right? So we all make mistakes, but sometimes there's monumental ones that sit on our mind. And I know you're a man of no regrets, right? So it's not about regrets, but yeah. It's like, when you think back to what is that one of those big mistakes that you've made in your time? What would that be?
I actually get asked that often, and I've got a great ability to move forward.
Yes.
And so I don't dwell. So I'd have to really think. Like right now, I'm going through some personal stuff.
Yeah.
So I could tell you a hell of a lot about that. But I don't think there's a point in going there. So ultimately, it's and I think there's a lesson in that, right? Like, so many people I see in real estate get held back from a mistake or a fuck up, and the mistake takes over them, right? And then they lose the momentum. Like, I think of such a big part of what I do is momentum. Mm-hmm. It's kind of like, often I make these sports analogies or comparisons, right? We talk about the greatest shooter of all time in NBA history, Steph Curry, legend. Some nights you see this guy, he can't hit a basket. It doesn't matter where he's shooting from. He goes zero from 22 and there's nothing he can do about it. But he never stops taking shots.
Yeah.
Because the next game, he comes back and he hits, you know, however many 10 from 10 in quarter one. And he's got this mindset that's built around resilience and continues to keep going until he gets the momentum in his favor. So the problem is with a mistake or when you screw up or if you dwell too much on what went wrong, it affects you rather than gives you positive experience. And I've just always had this ability to turn everything, even when it's negative, into a positive experience.
I love that. When you say that, and when I genuinely can tell that it would take time to go on the memory bank and think about those mistakes, the first thing I think about is cognitive load. And what I see what you're doing exceptionally well, whether it be intentional or not, is you, essentially that mistake has happened, you've learned from it, and it's like you wipe it from the CPU.
Correct.
And then therefore you have the cognitive load and the brain space to actually go and execute and perform, rather than that taking 7% of your memory. And it's constantly there. And I think that's what you need as a high performer.
Yeah, and that's tough, right? And I don't do it, that's just part of my process. I don't do it consciously. Yeah. It's just become such a part of my process. And I have days, whether it's personal or in business, when like it's over. It is over, dude. Like, and I mean, particularly being multifaceted I'm not just listing and selling anymore. I'm doing so much more. While still listing and selling at an even higher level than before. So there's much more load on. And I have to sometimes tell myself, right? Like, all you need is a good sleep.
Yeah.
You need to unplug from the matrix. You need to sleep. Sleep is my remedy. Sleep is my formula, right? When I've made a big mistake or I've had a big fuck up or I've had a really bad day, because it happens a lot. And I just don't let it affect the future. I go at it again the next day.
Love that. Now you touched on NBA, and of course it'd be silly not to add. I have one, but I want to come from a different angle, right? We know you're a sports fan. We know you love your NBA.
All sports. I mean, NBA is just something I thoroughly enjoy. But I'm kind of, I like sports in general. The mindset of athletes in general. Yeah,
I love that. And I think you know, of course, in the NBA we've got the Michaels and we've got the Kobe's of the world. You know, they're some of the best of the best, and they both shared a coach, as you I'm sure are very aware, is Tim Grover.
Yep.
And Tim has a very interesting history and interesting past, which I reflected and heard on a podcast. And,
right.
And one of Tim's things was, he believes in every high performer, there is a light side and there is a dark side.
Yeah.
And the dark side for Tim was something, have you heard of it before?
I actually got sent it, but I didn't listen to it. I know Tim and I've heard a lot of his quotes, but I haven't.
The podcast is incredible and I encourage you to do it. For Tim, it was, he had to, at the end of anatomy class, his dad essentially would have to decapitate the bodies.
Wow.
And he would have to watch that because his mum was working by night and he wasn't allowed at home.
Right.
And so from the age of 4, he would watch that happen until he grew up every single day. And so that's what he called his dark side.
Yeah.
And he said often with high performance, the dark side is the thing that you either run from or that drives you.
Yeah.
And so my question is, what's Gav's dark side?
That's a good question, man. I like that. My dark side. I think the sacrifice over the years, you know, you and I are having a conversation about you being married, and you mentioned you're with your high school sweetheart. And I mean, it would, it, like I said, it would have been lovely to have an experience like that. Everything happens how it's supposed to, but you know, for me, and I'm not saying get the violins out and be sorry for me, because I'm in a great position. I'm very grateful for everything that's going on in my life, good and bad. There's had to be sacrifices. Like, there's had to be friend sacrifices. There's had to be family sacrifices, relationship sacrifices. Like I said, my commodity has been time. My commodity has been energy. And I've had to dedicate that to what I've got now and have to continue to do that in order to get to where I want to go. So, look, other than that, is would I call that a dark? I don't know that I'd even, because to me, it hasn't been dark to sacrifice. Yeah. To me, it's been effortless. And I know that's going to sound maybe a bit strange, but I've been so focused on what I wanted and where I'm going that I've just accepted it as part of the process, right? Like, obsession. But again, to me, I don't, do I classify that as dark? And again, that's part of the process. Mm-hmm. If you want to be great at something, you've got to be obsessed with it. It's got to encompass you. Yeah. Great question. Let me think about it more and I'll come back.
I like it. Well, let me follow that through. So we're 80 years old. We're sitting on the couch. Yeah. You're sipping on a nice, whatever you might be sipping on, a tea, a scotch, whatever. And you're reflecting and you ask yourself the question, was the sacrifice worth it?
Yeah.
What would you say?
Yeah, 100%. If, and like, I don't know what the next, I'm 35, so 80s, you know, 45 years away, right? Mm. So I don't know what the next 45 years brings, but if I got hit by a car tomorrow, I'm fucking smiling from ear to ear. And I mean that, like wholeheartedly. I have zero regrets. And I'm looking forward to the future. I think definitely my needs and wants and ambitions on a personal level are shifting and have shifted. Like, I definitely now like the idea of, you know, meeting the girl that I can have a future with, meeting the girl I can bring up a family with. Like, that's starting to become very much something that appeals to me. I'm 5 years, 4 years off 40, right? Mm-hmm. I said 30. See, I'm living in the dark. But yeah, I think I always plan, and I'm always where I'm supposed to be, doing what I'm supposed to be doing at that time. So I think when I'm 80, please God, if I get there, I'll be very, very happy and not surprised, much like, you know,
I love that.
The question you asked me at the start.
That's awesome. So now I want to shift, and I want to focus on the business that you've created and really hone in on high performance.
Yeah.
So I, there's nothing I love more than high performance. And what I can tell from your journey, as well as the people in this building today, you know, from you know, just the 10 minutes I was in here,
yeah,
is you have a culture of high performance.
Yeah, 100%.
And so my question is, one, how do you build? Two, how do you maintain? And three, how do you continually push a high performance culture in a business?
Well, it's kind of much the same as what I said before. You've got to lead from the
from
the front. Like, if I was taking holidays every single week, not showing up early, not waking up early, not working till late, not performing at a high level myself, who's setting the example? Who's the spearhead of the arrow? I'm completely aware that I set the tone for the energy.
Yeah.
I set the tone for the performance. And I think whilst I continue to do that, and I really don't see that ending anytime soon, even when and if I have a family, even with, like, that for me is the next 20 years, 25 years plus for sure. That will continue to be what TRG is, right? And I think it's just as simple as that. Lead from the front, right? Lead from the front. When you say or ask, am I a perfectionist? I like to more so think I've got very high standards. And those standards are not for everybody, right? Personally and professionally. And I'm cutthroat around it, right? If you're not up to standard, TRG's not for you. Like, it's interesting, I've had so many young people for associate roles with other agents, not necessarily myself, but I'm very involved in the recruitment process for everybody here because I attract a lot of guys who want to work in the industry. And you've had so many young guys turn over here. They come in and they come out because they think, TRG, sparkly and pretty from the outside. What they don't understand is what makes us sparkly and pretty on the outside is that huge grit and sheer determination and commitment on the inside, right? Like it's pretty on the facade, but behind the curtain is it's you got to perform. And so a lot of these guys come and go versus, you know, the original guys who made the move to open the business with me. Every one of those guys is still here today. Mm. So I find that you're 100% right. That's a good observation. If they can't crack it and they can't perform, like, they always find their way to the door. Mm. But talent always seems to hang around.
Yeah.
And so for me, it's not about rushing to fill every seat tomorrow. Mm. It's about making sure we have the right people. People want to work hard to that work ethic piece I spoke about and be motivated by progression. And in time, the right people will all be here, and that's what we want.
Love that. And I love that you're still doing that interview process. That was something I held on to for as long as I physically could. You know, we got to a team of 400 people.
Wow.
And the amount of people that
I should be interviewing you, man.
The amount of people I interviewed, that was my thing. Like, yeah. I wanted to make sure we protect who's coming in here, because we're protecting for the people who are in here.
Yeah.
So my question to you is, is there a particular question or something that you're getting from, I understand you're not a resume man.
Yeah.
You and I share that
in
common.
How do you know that?
Man, I listen to all your content, brother. You mentioned it in
a podcast. No, because I'm not. I never read a resume. I've never read a resume.
We share that very much in common. You can put anything you want on paper, but I can tell pretty quickly. And so my question is, like, what is it that you're getting from that conversation in that interview that you go, these are the either key questions or characteristics that I cling on to, and I think the probability of success is increasing.
Well, it's hard to do these days because people have become very good at talking.
Very good.
You know, and they come in here and they talk and they promise the world. You know, they promise here and they deliver and they act here. So, I mean, it's a combination of things for me. First off, I go feeling. How do I feel about this person? How are they communicating to me? Are they maintaining eye contact? How are they looking? How are they? Do they smell good? Are they, you know, you're good, you're safe. I'm not hiring you. I should speak to you about hiring me. So that's a very, very small part of it. And then from there, I'm all about testing them.
Yeah.
I want to test them because today more than ever, actions, not words. I'm looking for how you act. I'm looking for what you do. I'm kind of not really fucking interested in what you say at all because I've heard it all. And I've been let down so many freaking times, man. And I'm over giving my time, which is very valuable, for or to people who don't want to hold up their end of the deal. You know, so for example, if someone comes and sees me, I'll purposely, you know, I want to be in real estate. Cool. Yeah. I'll purposely scare the shit out of them. And I'm gonna, but with the truth, not with a lie. Yeah. Like, let me tell you, this is the toughest sort of industry you could ever think of.
Yeah.
Whatever you think you know, you don't. It is an emotional roller coaster that will take you to the heights of exhilaration, to the depths of depression in 24 hours. Mm. And you're going to have to eat shit, metaphorically, for the first 3 to 5 years and make no money without giving up to even be at the table to potentially make a career out of this. So I want you to go away and think about that. And if you're still interested and you're still as excited as you were just before we started this conversation, call me on Tuesday. Mm. Then they'll call me on Tuesday. Whatever time, cool. Look, I'm a bit busy. Make sure you call me Friday, 7 p.m. Did they call me Friday, 7 p.m.?
Yes.
Cool. Let's just chat on the weekend. I've been crazy. They call me on the weekend. I'll test them 2-3 times. And I'm like, all right,
that's cool.
I'm going to give you a run because you've done what you said you were going to do, which, by the way, 90% of people, I'm sorry to keep swearing, I'm just passionate about this, 90% of people don't actually do. So I know that's a big part of the battle. I got two associates in here 2 years ago when they started with me. They had zero real estate experience. Mm-hmm. Now, a lot of people say, what do you take on someone without real estate experience? It's crazy. It's actually not. It's my formula because I can teach them and I can mold them, but they've got to have the will and the want to learn. Okay. One of them, in the first 6 months of this year, generated over $1 million in gross commission for me.
In the first 6 months of real estate?
Not his first 6 months, okay, in the first 6 months of this year, so he was a year and a half in the game.
Okay.
And that's not $1 million of deals he did.
Yep.
I obviously did the deals.
Yes, okay.
But the leads that he generated that came my way created $1 million of commission in the first 6 months.
Incredible.
So, and this guy's going to be a stud when in the next couple of years. And I'm trying to build a factory here whereby, you know, I can take people, train them up, and in a year or so he's going to go out on his own. He becomes a high performance agent here. He remembers all of the advice, support, loyalty, resources, everything I taught him. And essentially, if it works right, he performs here at a high level and we both benefit. That's poetry to me, you know what I mean? So that's really a part of what I'm doing now and a part of what I really enjoy.
That is honestly one of the coolest strategies I've had from an interview perspective. When you said test, I was like, I'm gonna ask you about that, and you elaborated perfectly. That is really cool. Has that shifted? Has that shifted since, because I understand the business now, you're probably getting calls all the time.
Yeah.
Like from the Luxe Listings, from everybody seeing you, you're getting calls from the agents.
Yeah, yeah.
Has that shifted, or has that kind of always been test?
No, it's definitely shifted, and it's been custom. I've built it through my experience, through my mistakes, through my screw ups, because, you know, at the start, everyone come over, you know, like, I'll take you. And you're just going back to time being one of my most precious commodities, and the majority of people letting me down. And it's a shame, but that's generally, and I am, that's for the most part, very few people are gonna do what they say they're gonna do from the start and actually will do what is required to succeed in this business, because it's hard.
One of the call outs I'm gonna make right there that I absolutely love about that strategy is, to your point, in my opinion, the more people that burn you from that when you hire them process, what happens is, it certainly happened to me, is almost the more bitter you become. And then the less that you bring the right energy to the new people, and therefore the less that you're gonna keep the right people. So I see that as like this ultimate sieve.
Yeah.
And that means that when the people come in, you've done a few tests, and therefore their probability is higher.
100%.
And your energy, then you're more willing and more able, and you're not gonna become that bitter old man.
Look, one of my favorite sayings, and I try to adopt this really every day, because you gotta understand, like, I know the perception is I just sell houses, but like, I'm swimming with the sharks every day. This is I saw a stat yesterday that Sydney had the second highest growth in the world in property just after Dubai. Wow. Like, we're a tiny, you know what I'm saying? Like the stakes are high, and also just going back to, I'm not just listing and selling.
Yeah.
I'm doing that at the highest level plus everything else. So one of the things I often tell myself professionally and personally is, get better, not bitter. I love that saying. So when you use that word bitter, I flip the perspective on it and always think about how we get better.
Yes.
Right? Because I think you can, it's a perspective narrative process, isn't it? Right? So like, when you think about getting bitter, I never do, I just get better.
That's epic. I love that. That's really, really cool. Let's touch on Luxe Listings.
Yeah.
So you've spoken about it. Everybody's seen you out there. The show has been an absolute success. What's the one thing that's come from it that you weren't expecting?
Being known as known. Well, I'm not known as, but I'm more known now than I was before, obviously. Mm-hmm. It's an international TV show, so let's call it that, right? It's a blessing and a curse.
Yeah.
Let's put it that way. The more known I get, the more private I want to be, right? And so it's interesting when you look at, or you speak to people who have known me since the start of my journey, I would put everything out on social, and you'd know everything about me here, and I would talk to anyone here, and anything I could do to promote myself or my brand, I would do. And I guess when you get to the point of a stage where you don't like some of the things that come with that, it's interesting because you do the opposite of what you did before. So that would be kind of, you never know who's watching. And I don't love that aspect of it, right? Yeah. But having said that, to do what I do, you've got to expose yourself. You've got to be comfortable doing it. So it's not like I'm not, I mean, you've seen me in front of a camera, I'm very comfortable. It's just more so, and I know this is going to sound funny because I am on a reality TV show and I am out there. A lot of aspects of my life I actually have always kept very private and I don't promote. And I hold firm to that and just will continue to do it.
Nice. And what's the biggest, like, the biggest blessing or the biggest impact that it's made to your life or your business?
Being more well known. but listen, and it's a blessing and a curse. And I find that, Frank, the universe always balances itself, right? So with all the good, has to come bad.
Yeah.
You don't just get good. if the universe goes, I'm going to give you good, they dish out some bad too, unfortunately. And so you have to accept that that is going to happen. And just like that's the part I don't like, what's been great from that is the business opportunities that have come my way, is the vendors who, you know, I never met, who said, we love the way you fight fearlessly for your clients and how you're so obsessed with this real estate thing and take it so seriously. You're the guy I want representing my sale. Or, you know, it's resulted in a conversation with an agent recruitment, and I've brought him across and built a great relationship with them, and they're helping me build my dream while I'm building theirs, you know? So it is the best, worst thing from it. What can I tell you?
I guess putting some meat on the potatoes around around your ability to remain as a sales lead and as a, you know, a very high performing salesperson is like, how much of GCI have you done in the last 12 months?
That I hate speaking about.
Okay, that's okay.
Because I've never liked to boast about the fees that I get paid for doing my job.
Yes.
Having said that, look, if you want to look, you can do your own research. I believe Ray White, it's public because the awards are based off of that.
Nice.
So I can tell you in the last 12 months that for Ray White as a group, and there's about 5,000 agents internationally, I was awarded the number one principal, and that's based on commission. And that's the second time I've got the principal award. And when I was a salesperson, I did it 7 times. So you talk about consistency.
Nice.
I've been doing okay for a consistent period of time.
Nice one. I like it. That's good. And I guess let's, as we start to wind up, is the last question for me is, what do you think? So, you know, the quote I think about often is, you know, what got me here won't get me there.
Ooh, I like that.
And my question to you is, you know, we are where we are today, but I know you've got a long way ahead of you. And so the question is, what do you think it is that you need to implement into your life, into your business, that's going to get you to exactly where you want to go?
It's all about the mindset for me. Mm-hmm. I think, unfortunately, and contrary to America, typical Australian culture is to bring people down, especially when they when they work their way up.
Yes, tall poppy syndrome.
Yeah, I think it's pretty prevalent around here.
Yeah.
So for me, it's not necessarily about, you know, being technical in a business strategy advisory, because I've got the best people, I've got the best team in the world, I've got the best people around me. My brother, you mentioned him, right? Him by my side, I feel very, very safe every day. I sleep very well. you know, I've got amazing representatives outside of the business who make sure everything is good. And that's always been, I would say, probably my biggest gift, even more so than selling houses, is attracting the highest caliber people, being able to build the best team. So for me, it's all about mindset. Like, the air I'm wanting to travel up to is, it gets thin. And I think so long as I have this well intact, and that's a constant working through process, I'm going to get to where I want to go. The only factor for me, and I've said this before, is time. There's a great quote, and I heard it only a couple of months ago. It says that when you're on the way up, people will root for you because you remind them of their dreams. Yes. But when you get there, they'll try to tear you down because you remind them that they gave up on them. And like, I just never gave up on my dreams, and I'm never going to. So, you know, we'll see where we get to.
That's so good. And it's so true. It's so true. So I want to drill into the mindset piece. How do you protect your mindset? Like, what are the things that you employ to do so?
I consume a lot of content that resonates with me that I can use to fortify my mind. And I write notes and I write lists, and whenever I'm feeling down or I feel like I need to, I go over them.
Nice.
And I focus on the close people in my life. I focus on my friends, because ultimately the opinion of them is all that concerns me. And I focus on the stuff that makes me happy. Like, life is short. We just spoke about before, if I get hit by a car tomorrow, I'm going with a big smile on my face. And I truly mean that, because I won't and I don't tolerate things that make me unhappy. Like, I've got a no arsehole policy with regard to now representing people. I've actually implemented that probably in the last 6 to 12 months. You know, I want to work with people who I enjoy working with, to appreciate the value I'm going to add, because I can add a lot of value to someone. And if they don't recognize and identify that, that's fine too. And there's so many other people that they can use, right? I want to hang out with people that stimulate me, that emotionally, that give me good energy. I want to spend more time with my parents. You know, I was even thinking this morning, I've never been overseas with them. I'm really focused on next year taking them both away overseas to Israel. We're not from Israel, Jewish heritage, obviously, but, you know, focusing on what makes me happy, all of that stuff contributes to mindset. At the same time, it's impossible to be naive and say you're always going to be happy and do and deal with everything that makes you happy. So be able to have the strength to weather the storm when the storms come up. But yeah, that's kind of how I do it.
Nice, love that. And you touched on there, which I love, is around the people you surround yourself with.
Yeah.
I've recently been thinking a lot about that. And it's something that I didn't necessarily do correct in the earlier days was two parts. There's one is like what you consume. So outside of work, it's like what you consume in terms of what you spend your time with consuming. You know, so for me, it was always, I was very particular about, I'm not a news guy because the energy is going to be
neither
giving
me,
giving me that. Yeah, yeah. And so it makes me a little bit boring when you want to talk about current affairs.
I'm the same. I'm the same. Yeah.
But the second one was around, and I have an amazing, I'm very thankful, amazing friends.
Yeah.
But it's now about surrounding myself with people that want to put like equally in different areas. I see them and I want to then push myself.
Yeah.
And so my question to you is, who are the people that you surround yourself with outside of this environment? And do they push you, or is it like?
Yeah. My brother's a big one. Mm-hmm. He's taught me so much, always, but particularly in the last 4 years, changed my life for the better. I've got a couple of really good mentors I work with.
Awesome.
They help a lot, and I'm very thankful for them. I've got a very good group of friends overseas, actually, who live in LA, a little bit older than me,
nice.
A lot more successful than me. And that's just different. It's just a different way of thinking over there. And they always give me golden nuggets when I need it. But yeah, genuine effort to make sure I'm never too comfortable and that I'm always learning.
Nice. Love that. Last question for me is, what haven't I asked you? What's top of mind for Gav?
What haven't you asked me? I don't know. I think we're good. I think you nailed it. I enjoyed that.
Awesome. Thank you, Gav.
Brother, it was a pleasure. Thanks for the pasta.
Thank you.